This is Jeffrey Sachs, editor of Tradition. We hope you've been enjoying the Tradition podcast and all of our weekly digital content. But I'm also hoping that you'll subscribe to Tradition to get everything that we have to offer in our quarterly print journal of Orthodox Jewish thought. Becoming a subscriber is the only way to make sure you don't miss the best writing in the Orthodox world on the most timely and timeless topics. Visit traditiononline.org to get home delivery and digital access to all the content in our archives, from our founding in 1958 right up to our most recent issue. That's over six decades of our community's most incisive, impactful, and reflective writing and scholarship. In Tradition's most recent fall issue, we published a wide-ranging review essay authored by Professor Jeffrey Wolf. The essay surveys the scope and significance of the writings of Rabbi Professor Isidore Yitzchak Twersky, Zichrono Levracha, which were recently collected and published in Hebrew as Kimayan HaMitgaber, edited by Professor Carmi Horowitz and published by Merkaz Zalman Shazar. Visit traditiononline.org for open access to that review essay. Rabbi Twersky, who passed away in 1997, was a Hasidic Rebbe heading the Talmud Shnibel and university professor at Harvard, where he was an internationally recognized authority on rabbinic literature and Jewish philosophy, recognized especially for his scholarship on Maimonides. But for those who knew him, especially his Hasidim and graduate students, and those who could lay claim to both titles, Rabbi Twersky was really so much more than these lines from his CV. We thought it would be interesting to put Professors Wolf and Horowitz together for a conversation. As you'll hear, they discussed a wide range of subjects. Why translate Professor Twersky's English articles for an Israeli audience? What was his unique contribution to Jewish studies? Why did he emphasize the interaction of spirituality and halakha? Did his various identities come together somehow? And what's the long-range import of his work and scholarship? Carmi Horowitz has taught at Ben-Gurion University and Bar-Ilan University, served as rector of the Touro Graduate School of Jewish Studies in Jerusalem and of Lander Institute, as president of the Givat Washington Teachers College, and as head of the Michlala Yerushalayim Graduate Program in Jewish Thought. Jeffrey Wolf teaches in the Talmud department at Bar-Ilan University and has published widely on an array of topics in Jewish history, literature, and thought. Both Professors Horowitz and Wolf completed their doctorates with Professor Twersky at Harvard. Here's their conversation.
Professor Twersky, let's start Medias in Res. And let me ask you a question. When you started the project, how did the project come about? And what did you hope to achieve by translating all of Professor Twersky's writings into Hebrew? And what was the who's your target audience?
Okay. Well, first, just for the listeners, we should clarify that we're talking about a new collection of Professor Twersky's major articles, some of which were originally written in English, some of which were originally written in Hebrew. All of the English articles were translated into Hebrew, and they were put together in a volume of 31 articles, all in Hebrew, a 760-page book. The project started during Professor Twersky's lifetime, and a bit selfish from my point of view, because when I was teaching in various academic situations, I wanted to make his articles available to the Hebrew-speaking public. The majority of them were in English. And Professor Twersky's English is not an easy read. He formulated his sentences with exquisite care, but the exquisite care made them very tight and required a great deal of unpacking in order to understand it.
I'll interject that my wife often commented that, of course, Religion and Law is one of the most formative and repercussive articles he ever wrote. And I would assign it for two reasons. First, because I thought they should read it, and B, because as in our department for a long time, we had a requirement that in advanced courses, you have to have a certain number of articles in English, and to which my wife would inevitably exclaim, but that's not English. That's not English that they're gonna understand, for which 10 units of English on the Israeli comprehensives are not gonna get you there.
I will complement that with another story. I met a few years ago towards the end of the production of the book with Mrs. Tversky, and I was telling her about the difficulties in translating her late husband's articles. And she smiled and she said, yes, I know. My husband used English in a very creative way. And the truth of the matter is that that creativity often was not caught by some of the translators who would prefer to go in a literal way, which of course required a lot of corrections and a lot of different translators. They got better as we went along in order to make it accessible. Professor Tversky, when I proposed the project to him originally, said, no, all Israeli academics can read my English. But then he realized that it's not the case, and he agreed to the translation. The first translated articles actually were translated during his lifetime. We had two of them that he actually saw before he passed away. And from his critical remarks on the translation, I realized that I had a big job ahead of me. Unfortunately, he passed away and was not able to supervise it, but I realized how carefully he would insist upon the translation. And I believe that in the end, we achieved a translation that in a sense made the articles more accessible, at least to Hebrew readers, than the English are to English readers. As a matter of fact, somebody told me that they read English fluently, but they prefer the Hebrew version because it's been made more accessible. And we made it more accessible, yet being very strict on being loyal to the original terminology.
That's certainly true. I would just add that Rabbi Hillel Goldberg, who is one of the editors of Tradition, I had the privilege of seeing an advanced copy of his book of collected essays, and he has he was profoundly influenced by Professor Tversky, and in his recollection of him, he mentioned something which can't by definition come out in the translation, is that he was I don't know what the word is. He loved to create rhymed couplets. And rhyming couplets of words, critical, conceptual, all these.
A tremendous amount of alliteration.
Which obviously came very easily to him because his writings are so rife with them that he can't have spent all that much time coming up with these. So these must have come quite naturally to him.
They flowed out naturally from him. And of course, in the Hebrew, we couldn't catch the alliteration, but even in his Hebrew writings, he would use alliteration in the Hebrew. In other words, he was very, very, he had a tremendous aesthetic view of language and how it's presented. And we tried to preserve it in the Hebrew to the best of our ability. But in any case, the main goal of putting all these articles together is, first of all, most of them appeared in out of the way places that are not ordinarily accessible. They were in Jubilee volumes in memory of this person or another one. Those are the kind of books that appear once and then disappear from the shelves. They were in some periodicals that are also not easily available. And anybody who wanted to access his articles really had to search very hard. They were not easily accessible. So now we've presented all of the major articles together in one volume, which makes it accessible. But beyond that, the very fact that they all stand together produces something new. It's true that these articles already, the last one was written 25 years ago, but the view of the extent of his interests, of his knowledge, and the types of things that he was interested in hit the reader just by viewing the table of contents. When you see the table of contents and you see, we know that Professor Tversky was an expert on the Rambam, and indeed 14 of the 31 articles are dedicated to the Rambam, but the others are all over the place. And they touch on important halachic scholars, they touch on intellectual history, they touch on halacha and meta halacha, which we'll talk about eventually, and also contemporary issues like Zionism and Jewish studies in the modern era are included in the volume. So you see a very wide range of topics, and of course the content of each one is very thorough and very deep.
I agree. I think that one point that should be emphasized to the listeners is the fact that while he was very, very, certainly concentrated on the Rambam, and everything at the end of the day came down to the Rambam. In fact, I remember when I presented my own doctoral topic on Rabbi Joseph Colonna, 15th century Italy, and I had a whole list of reasons why I thought he was worth writing on. And at the end, he said, you know, he was a very fine student of the Rambam. And I just sat there going, idiot, I should have said that first. What's the matter with me? Anyways, the point I wanted to make was, despite that focus, even the Rambam was brought to a large degree. He approached the Rambam in terms of the entire sweep of Jewish intellectual history. He did. It's true. He was criticized for not emphasizing or not sufficiently fleshing out the Gaonic connection. But nevertheless, every single article is a study of everything that was ever said, or much that was said in different countries, in different places, by different people, in different eras, on the same issue, or how the point at Bar is echoed later. So that everything, there's always tremendous focus, but everything, but that focus is always in light of the totality of Jewish creativity and Jewish intellectual creativity. I mean, otherwise you wouldn't be able to. I mean, you have, for example, religion and law. He starts with a verse in Jeremiah, and he ends up with the Chafetz Chaim in the same footnote. That's a long time. And many of the studies are like that. I mean, I remember as a student, again, I remember we had this meeting of all the graduate students, and we asked him, what are you supposed to know? And he just looked at us and said, everything. Which is daunting, I have to say.
My time also, I remember a similar statement. Yes, very much so. But here I think that we should emphasize that the Rambam was symbolic of Professor Tversky's commitment to the centrality of halakha in all of Jewish history. I think Absolutely. This is one element that he repeatedly emphasized, and he was amazingly successful in putting the study, the academic study of halakha per se, onto the agenda, to the extent that when we had a conference on the book a few months ago, most of the speakers recognized his contribution to encouraging study of halakha as part of the flow of Jewish history. But Professor Tversky's approach, his own approach to the study of halakha, was a very broad, as you said, Jeffrey, was a very broad conception. In other words, it was not a history of the halachic decisions of the poskei halakha, of those who decide, of the decisors of halakha, but he saw halakha in its broader cultural terms. And his book, Introduction to the Mishneh Torah, I think represents that, because he didn't deal with the Rambam's specific decisions. He dealt with literary, historical aspects of the Mishneh Torah, and he places the Mishneh Torah and its study in the in the context, in the broad context of the study of the humanities. And he brings an amazing amount of insight from the area of humanities in understanding what the Rambam is doing in terms of the way he organized the Mishneh Torah, in terms of the themes in Mishneh Torah, in terms of its comprehensiveness, in terms of the relationship to halakha and meta halakha. And all of a sudden, Mishneh Torah, which is thought of as a halachic book, becomes a volume of amazing breadth in his hands.
Let me ask a question. In light of that, what emerges is a picture of the Mishneh Torah as a, I'll use one of his favorite words, topos, as an example of the totality of Jewish religiosity through deed and through emotion and through intellection and so on. What's interesting in that regard is the fact that you can look at it, I don't know if he thought about it this way, and maybe you can enlighten us, that there is an implicit, or at least I see it as an implicit response to the continual criticism of rabbinic Judaism by everything from Christians to Reform, all the way up to Reform Judaism, which saw halakha as an impediment to spirituality, as something which is dry and something which is fossilized. And here he presents halakha as something which is a vehicle for the only vehicle actually for the effective channeling and expression of one's relationship with God. I am nervous about the word spirituality. One's relationship with God and a guarantor of persistency in Avodas Hashem, in the worship of God, as opposed to a purely subjectivist kind of approach, which can be, first of all, only occasional sense of maybe, you know, as the spirit moves me, and second of all, totally undisciplined and hence liable to easily lose its integrity. Do you think he had that in mind when he decided to focus on this, or just my imagination?
Not only did he have it in his mind, I think it became a central element in all of his studies. We have to remember that the basis for the academic study of Judaism began in the 19th century, and many of the originators of what was known as Wissenschaft des Judentums, right, the science of Judaism, came from a point of view that relegated halakha as a peripheral element in Judaism and at best. And Professor Tversky built upon the knowledge and the research that was achieved in the Wissenschaft des Judentums, but he was determined to bring it, to take it in another direction. And what Professor Tversky does again and again, he shows that in his terms, there is halakha and there is meta halakha. In other words, and meta halakha has been used in various ways, but his sense of it is that halakha requires additional intellectual investment in order to elicit from the halachic system next to the halachic system a basis for spirituality that will complement the halakha. And indeed, he had a major project which he was not able to complete to study this whole phenomenon throughout Jewish history. In the book, there are three or four articles along those lines, but he wasn't to complete it. And I guess he'll leave it for the next generation to take it to complete that.
It makes me think of the two questions and a memory. I recall that one of the things that had us do while we were at Harvard was to make sure that we, what did he call it, take advantage of the riches at Harvard, most of the time meant sitting in Widener Library and reading, but much of it was also to come to know other members of the faculty with whom he had good relations and with whom who could enrich our own studies. So I spent a year, I think one of the most memorable years of my life, studying privately. It was almost a tutorial with Professor Charles Constable, who recently passed away. I think he was almost 100. And they had planned, actually, he and Professor Constable had planned to write a book together on the ragged edges of medieval intellectual history, exploring specifically this issue of religiosity and spirituality and formal and ritual forms, which is interesting from the point of view of the Catholic Church that he studied and this. So he didn't. It wasn't. He didn't set up. When you said he brings the whole humanities to bear, that you have to see that that was writ very, very widely in terms of the way that he defined it. But that's not the point I wanted to make. One point was your point about the Wissenschaft origins of Jewish studies, which meant primarily Jewish studies for many, many years was overwhelmingly identified with Reform and later with conservative Judaism. Orthodox Jews, to a very, very minor degree, participated, even they were suspect. Shir, who was the Shlomo Yehuda Rappaport, who was the son-in-law of the Ketos HaChoshen, and I remember we once had a student at Harvard who was writing about Shir, and when that person saw the picture of Shir with a shreimel and a talis ivrim cup, that person almost like wanted to drop dead because they didn't know that Shir had been that familiar with long pace. Anyways, but he was the exception, and he was sort of taken with. I remember in yeshiva somebody telling me that he was the Katsosa's son-in-law, and he wrote the I think it was like the index to the Yavne Miluim, but everybody knows the Yavne Miluim is not as good as Ketzos HaChoshen. Kilu, that's the reason, because Kashir wasn't as great as Talmud Chacham. But the point is, I wonder if one of the things that Professor Twersky achieved more broadly was to make a career in Jewish studies possible for a person who was for somebody who was Orthodox,
absolutely, I think that he was very concerned with his students and helping them and seeing them that they would continue in academia. And I think many of the students have continued and have perpetuated his idea. But I want to go back to one point because it connects to a story that just happened to me recently in terms of the image of the Rambam as a halachic scholar. I was teaching a class recently on Zoom in Argentina, actually, and in my introduction, I cited two views of the Rambam, which appear in actually in chapter 6 of the book. And they note the kedushato v'chasiduto shel HaRambam, his saintliness and his holiness. And one of the students, this is a group of rabbis actually in South America that I was teaching to it, and he almost jumped from his seat. I mean, he was in Zoom, but he almost jumped from his seat and said, "Where do we see the Rambam's saintliness and the Rambam's holiness?" And actually, there's, I would say that almost the whole section of the book, the second section where we see the themes that Professor Twersky picked up in Maimonides' writings, in which he emphasizes the elements of spirituality in the Rambam, whether it be in saintliness, whether it be in the areas of charity, and I would like just to cite one sentence of the Rambam, in Hilchot Matnot Aniyim, in the laws that deal with the charity, and the Rambam there deals with the case in which a person asks for charity from somebody and he doesn't have any money. So the Rambam says that he has to be very sensitive to this person and encourage him, and then he says v'oy lemi shet. In other words, the Rambam reacts so viscerally about right. The importance that one has to have sensitivity to the needs of the poor people. And I was told that Rabbi Chaim Brisk once related to this double oi in the Rambam. In other words, the extreme sensitivity that a person must have towards poor people. And this is just one very small example of the Rambam's extreme ethical sensitivity that runs through the entire Mishneh Torah. And that was part of his vision of halakha being containing a great deal of ethical issues, and I'll use the word spiritual because I think it is spiritual notions throughout the Mishneh Torah and throughout his works.
No, the word for my objection to the word spirituality is it's usually used in a desiccated form to mean some kind of like amorphous whatever without any connection to God. I'm not into God. I'm into spirituality. Well, hello. I mean, that's what it is. Yeah. You're mentioning Reb Chaim, and we'll get to Beta Halach in a minute. But you're mentioning Reb Chaim raises the obvious question. I think that I don't know if our readers are aware of this. I mean, I'm assuming that our listeners are aware of the fact that Professor Tversky wore a triple crown. He was a scion of the Talner dynasty, and his the Rav Zatzal called his father the saint, the epitome of the saint's teacher, and we both had this chus of I knew him after the stroke. You probably knew him before the stroke. But my recollections of the Talmud Rebbe, his father, of those eyes that could pierce you, like just even when he was, even you could see his sanctity, is the personality of the man, even though he was not able to speak. He was also the premier student of one of the two major the only major figures in Jewish studies in America at the time. Was Harry Wolfson was his student or teacher, and the other one was Sallah Baron, who at the time was at Columbia. And of course, he was Reb Soloveitchik's son-in-law. And I quite, you know, having spent many, many years, we both were told me to know the Rav as well, and knew the Rav informally as well. I can't help but seeing Professor Tversky mentions in the beginning of his first book of Nuraivit about the impact of his father-in-law on him and on his life has been incalculable or immeasurable, I think is the word. And I can't help but thinking that to a certain degree, Professor Tversky sort of mapped out historically, using the tools of history of ideas, a major focus or a major axis of the Rav's writings of the absolute need to instill the halach, what he would, I think, probably call the halachic gesture with emotional and spiritual and religious and ethical and intellectual content. Otherwise, the halachic gesture is woefully insufficient. So I wonder, I mean, I don't know who got what idea from whom, but I get the strong impression that there are two sides of, in a significant degree, two sides of the same coin.
I'm glad that you mentioned that fact of the triple crown that he wore, because I think that made him very, very unique in the history of Jewish studies. A personality that drew from the academic study of Judaism, who was close to the major Talmudic scholar of the generation, Rabbi Soloveitchik, who was his father-in-law. And incidentally, he learned with his father-in-law every Friday for 30 years.
I know, I tried to get a Friday morning appointment with him.
I'm sorry?
I once tried to get, I called the Rav, but I wanted an appointment with him on a Friday morning, and he said, no, I can't do it.
He couldn't, correct.
I didn't know, but the Rav was at the time.
Yes, and that, put it this way, not only in the Rivet and even the introduction to the Mishneh Torah, let me just one sentence. I repeatedly, he talks about his father-in-law, benefited from his immense, genuinely effervescent learning and was warmed by his unfailing devotion. And of course, his training with Harry Wolfson, perhaps the greatest historian of Jewish philosophy at Harvard University, but the student, Professor Tversky, took the Litauer chair, which was given originally to Harry Wolfson, and he received it after Wolfson retired. He took it in a completely different direction. Whereas Harry Wolfson saw as philosophy as the bridge to the humanities generally, and that's how to fit Jewish studies, independent Jewish studies in the university, Professor Tversky insisted on bringing halakha. And the fact that a student of Wolfson wrote his doctoral dissertation on the Rivet who was the major halachic scholar at the time, much older than the Rambam, and of course critiqued the Rambam as well, but a study of halachic scholar showed the centrality of halacha. Now, despite the fact that he drew from his father-in-law, he drew from his father as well, and the Rabbi Twersky was the Tolner Rebbe in Boston, and he had a Beis Medrash, and he had a Shalashudis, and he gave a Shiur in Gemara. So he was very deeply entrenched in his Beit Midrash. He was very deeply entrenched in his Harvard chair. And as a matter of fact, he initiated a great deal in the area of Jewish studies at Harvard University, setting up the Center of Jewish Studies, making it a major focus of conferences and studies and volumes that were produced during his reign as the chairman right. of the Center of Jewish Studies. And of course, a loyal student of his father-in-law. And of course, we know that one of the themes of Rabbi Soloveitchik's writings deal with issues of spirituality, that deals with the experience, the existential experience of a mitzvot. And I think that element influenced the son-in-law as well as seeking it out in his way. Not exactly the way Rabbi Soloveitchik did it, but he
he was not, I remember two things just about the Rav, in contrast to Professor Twersky, I usually don't tell story, you know, third-hand stories about the Rav, but in both these cases, that they were, I was there and I was involved. Once the Rav asked who was Rabbi Yehuda, when did Rabbi Gershom live? So I said he was a student of Rabbi Leon Tan, which is historically correct. And the Rav said, no, Charlemagne. Because the Rav was quoting for our listeners, there's a tradition that's brought down by the Rokeach that the great migration north to from Italy to Germany was the time of Charlemagne. And so that's what the Rav said. So, you know, so obviously history wasn't just in Rabbi Leon Tan, who was the mysterious rabbi, a teacher of Rabbi Yosham. And the other time, I met him at the Twersky's house, and he asked me what I was doing there. So I said, I came to bring a chapter to my doctorate. And he was happy. He says, what are you writing about? I said, Maharik. He says, oh, yeah, Chachmei Ashkenaz. And he walked on. So here I'm writing, you know, hundreds of pages, and he reduced it all to one word because it's, you know, one part of Chachmei Ashkenaz, and where he lived wasn't all that important. So there's definitely a contrast. Mm-hmm. But let's come back to this question of halacha and meta halacha. Because at a certain degree, the word meta halacha is bandied around a lot. And I think I was under the impression that Professor Twersky invented it. He coined the phrase. He certainly was the one who made it popular, especially in words that he used to use all the time in a Protean highly repercussive article that he published in 1970. Non halachic themes in the Mishneh Torah. Was it 71, 72?
No, Halan Halachic was 60...
69, 68. Yeah. Anyways, it was late 60s. Anyways, how would you define what he was trying to point out there? I mean, some of it we've touched on. And how do you think he defined, what's your impression of how he defined the word meta halacha?
Okay, so actually...
What isn't meta halacha?
He has one of his outstanding articles. I mean, of course, they all are, but one really... impressive article is an article called Talmudus Philosophers Kabbalist, The Quest for Spirituality in the 16th Century. And there actually he deals with the definition of meta halacha. And basically what he's trying to say here is that beyond the study of halacha, halachic scholars realize the need for something to complement the halacha, not to take its place, but something that in a sense is, on the one hand, is beyond halakha. As a matter of fact, let me use his own words. the importance of study and the concomitant relation between cognitive effort, however directed, and the attainment of spirituality, however defined, study as an indispensable prerequisite and catalyst. In other words, that there are areas which halakha tells you what to do, but what about the experience, the living of halakha? And that's what he pointed out, that there are many, what he called meta-halachic disciplines. In other words, many disciplines from which one can derive principles and ideas which will help develop this experiential element of the halakha, such as philosophy and such as Kabbalah, not limited to them, but those are two major examples of disciplines which we see throughout history accompanied halachic scholars through the generations.
I'd like to sharpen that a little bit and just point out a couple of things that mean, and just let me also try to crystallize what you said. The that means, and that this was a major point, that spirituality or the development of the non-legal aspects of Jewish religious life it's not a subjective, we're not talking about meditation, we're not talking about mantras. We're talking actually, it's always involved in some form of study. There's mind and heart always together that are meant to then expand the soul, expand the mind, and then be infused into the act of observance. So that's number one. The number two is the fact that the function of all of these disciplines is fundamentally interpretive, in the sense that they provide two things there were two fundamental components to the spiritual life. One is what I think Peter Berger would have called the sacred canopy. In other words, the religious context, the values, the ideals, the goals, the ideas of who is man and where is he going and what are our aims and what is all of Haba about and so on and so forth. In other words, the things that envelop the world, that envelops you, fashions you, guides you almost intuitively at some point in one's religious quest, and also providing reasons that are connected to this sacred canopy of the mitzvot. In other words, that's why tamei mitzvot, the reason for commandments, it looms so large. First of all, in the classic sixth chapter of the book on Maimonides, but also all kinds of other places. And there were doctorates that he tried to have done that focused on people's systems of commandments. I don't think anybody got out of whether we were there for 4 years or in my case 15 years. They got out of Harvard without having sat through four or five weeks worth of plowing through the third chelik of the Mar Nebuchim, starting with chapter 26, sometimes 27, sometimes 26, and going through the Tami Mitzvahs part. I think that's important. I think it's important not just per se, but it also relates to the question of what constitutes meta halacha. One of the differences between the way people describe this is that the way that Fersatorsky defined meta halacha, these are disciplines which are critical for the successful negotiation and experience of Judaism, but they never impinge upon halacha per se. The autonomy of halacha is always preserved. I mean, some cases he shows in the Rambam, for example, his discussions of Hilchas Mezuzah, where it comes close, but he's talking there about customs and not about actual laws. He keeps the two spheres very, very separate to preserve the integrity of halacha. A position, by the way, which was endorsed independently by Professor Yaakov Katz, who was a very frequent flyer, frequent guest at Harvard over the years. Today, people use the word, what?
Go ahead. No, you're making a very important point.
So the second point is that the second half is that today the word, I think he would say, was misused, that meta halakha refers to values which can be brought to impinge upon the halachic process. And there, I think he would disagree with the use of, first of all, meta means outside, but let's free or beyond. But they'll say, you know, okay, subjective things like equity and justice and stuff like that, which have roles in halakha, but in fact, in situ, never violate the bottom line of a psak. In more liberal discussions, they'll use meta halacha and say, "Well, we have meta halacha, and therefore we can change halacha." That was not the sense in which the term is used by Fristorsky in his writings.
Definitely, I'd like two comments on what you said, and I agree with everything that you said. I would say, first of all, the issue of meta halacha as being an independent but intellectual discipline. As a matter of fact, in that article that I just cited in the long footnote, he quotes the Mesilat Yesharim, where the Mesilat Yesharim says that saintliness, that chassidut, is not saying Pirkei Tehillim and fasting and all kinds of exercises like that. It requires intellectual effort of study in order to achieve this level of chassidut. So that, I think that was a very important aspect for Professor Tversky in understanding the nature of meta halakha. And also what he insisted on is that philosophy, Jewish philosophy, exists as an independent discipline that can be studied. And the history of Kabbalah is an independent discipline that can be studied, but they can also be seen as areas that provide the halakha with a horizon that gives expression to important spiritual and existential values. And what he wanted to show is that overwhelmingly halachic scholars recognize this. There were halachic scholars that did take exception, and there were periods of time in Jewish history in which the focus in many of the yeshivot, and you could take 19th century Lita, was also to a certain extent like that, a focus of exclusive Talmudism. However, it was very rare that you find halachic scholars that rejected completely additional areas. They were suspicious. For example, one of Professor Tversky's examples, is the Musar movement, that Rabbi Yisrael Salanter wanted to introduce Musar into the yeshivot in Eastern Europe, and he was thrown out of the Beit Midrash. They didn't want to hear of anything that will distract students from the exclusive study of Talmud. So you see.
I think we should give a little bit of credit to Reb Chaim Volozhiner. One of the things is you're from the Doros HaRishonim and I'm from the B'yamei HaBinayim, because they were also Doros HaChronim. One of the seminars, we had the privilege of having a little seminar on, it was called Rabbinic Texts, whatever he wanted to talk about. So one of the things we did do was we studied the fourth shar of the Nefesh HaChayim. And one of the points of the by Reb Chaim Volozhiner, it's his great manifesto, his attempt to try to create a counter, I guess, to the Tanya. That's the tradition in the Lithuanian yeshivas. Mm-hmm. But one of the things that he pointed out is the fact that that the assumption of Reb Chaim was that it's not that Talmudocentrism was bereft of spirituality. The idea was that Talmudocentric study, that Talmudism could provide by itself both elements, both the spiritual element and not. And then it's in that regard, I just want to make sure what number chapter was. The first three chapters in the fourth shar, he lays out the definition of Torah Lishma. And then in the fourth chapter, he stops for a minute and he says, doesn't mean you shouldn't have Yerush Shamayim. You should sit there and meditate for a few minutes and put yourself in the right frame of mind before you study. So Professor Tversky said two things, which I think are intriguing. And the truth is, for all these years, I've been meaning to check to see if Dr. Lamb picked it up in his book, Torah Lishma. He said, he used to define, parenthetic statements, that if you can find a statement in a book and you pull out the statement and the paragraph or the sentence still flows, that's a parenthetic statement. He says, if you read the Nefesh HaChayim, it looks like chapter four was sort of like added later, because it, you can go from 3 to 5 without missing a beat. So he says he thought that what happened over here was Reb Chaim actually began to have second thoughts about the ability of pure Talmud study to be able to provide the kind of spiritual ambiance in which Talmud Torah is also an act of worship. So he sort of stuck it in and said, but don't think that, you know, this isn't whatever. But apropos,
yeah, I'd just like to add one important aspect of Professor Tversky's scholarship, and that's the wide range of types of Jewish literature which he saw as important. In other words, it wasn't only Talmud, Halakha, philosophy and Kabbalah, but he would have classes in poetry, in ethical literature, in biblical exegesis, in sermon literature, in polemics. He saw the importance of Jewish culture across the board, and as a tool for the study of Jewish intellectual history, he claimed that some of these, quote, secondary works are perhaps of even greater importance. If you take, for example, the sermon literature, the drasha literature, where there we see how the ideas of the outstanding thinkers trickled down to the masses and got spread out. And that so aspect—
My mother had an expression, Yaden Darshan Darshan Bazich, since I put in a plug for the Marik, so since you wrote about the drashot of Ibn Shuib. So, okay, we're good. I'd like to take a couple of minutes just to close with this. The Rambam in the Morne Buchim makes the startling assumption or assertion that prayer that vocalized prayer is a something of a concession to human beings. That ultimately really lechadu miyatihila, language collapses in the face of God, and it's actually a tremendous gift that God gave us the opportunity to be able to talk, because really it's an incomprehensible activity that we indulge in when we pray. Mm-hmm. Silence was one of the Professor Tversky's favorite modes of being. He mentions his silences in the introduction to the book, that only Dr. Atira Tversky really understood his silences. But the silences that he manifested in as our teacher set a very high bar, made the experience of studying with him very, very exacting. He had an incredibly high standard of expectation and of production and what we're supposed to produce. And I was wondering, I know that as hard as it was, I know that it made me a better scholar, maybe a better person, maybe better I think it certainly helped my learning. The question is, nowadays, when we see students more as consumers than as disciples and as those who are obligated to be meshabed themselves to their teachers, the question is whether the kind of approach that we thrive, that we grew on, is it still possible, and is it retrievable?
Put it this way, I think that to a certain extent, he used silence, but not in a negative sense, but in a creative sense, meaning that the importance of carefully formulating whatever you're going to say. And if you say something, then it has to have meaning. It has to have content. In other words, and here he took 2 halachot in Hilchot Deyot, and in one of his shiurim that he gave in memory of the Rav, which is going to be published later this year, he emphasized the Rambam's conception of silence, not only as not speaking, but as speaking, but with quality and with content, and not just saying something for the sake of saying something. And I think that's something that it was important to train others in that way, not just to talk and talk and talk with lack of precision and with lack of understanding. But when you say something, you should say something with precision, with understanding, with a basis for what
that's
you're
why
saying.
He liked it. That's and why he liked that letter of the Rambam. That's why he loved that letter of the Rambam, where the Rambam says, you don't appreciate what I did here. You guys don't understand how much time I spent making sure. And the truth of the matter is that we all read that letter, but I was working on my proposal, I think. And I was in the library, in the back of the library was an exhibit on the occasion, I think it was the 800th anniversary of the completion of the Mishneh Torah. And there were some fragments from the Geniza in which you could see the Rambam cried, there wasn't any tipex, and there wasn't that whiteout, and there wasn't any cry, you know, cut and paste, where the Rambam crosses out and writes over and crosses out and write over. And you know, you understand where this, another level, another point of a place where Professor Twersky's identification with the Rambam was so, it was so intense and so real. Carmi, we could go on like this.
Maybe a concluding statement that we've dealt with various aspects of Professor Twersky. There are many more to be spelled out, but I think that his connection and his interest in Jewish education was a very important aspect of his life and his personality. As well as the centrality of Eretz Yisrael in his entire life, something which Absolutely. He had hoped to come and open up his own Beis Medrash in Yerushalayim, but we were not zocha to it. Those are, I think, two elements that are also require expansion and discussion, not in this context, but Absolutely. Those are also elements in his personality.
Absolutely. I would also like to mention, though, the fact that I'm very grateful for to Rabbi Jeffrey Sachs, my friend and neighbor, for inviting me to write the review that appeared in this latest issue of Tradition. It gave me an opportunity to. It was very cathartic. I have to say, it was cathartic because there were a lot of things there that had been cooking in my head for a long time, in terms that I wanted to say the proper way. I'm grateful to Carmi for putting out the book and for both per se and also for bringing Twersky's writings to a broader audience. And the context of doing this on Tradition is very, very important, because I wrote at the end of the essay, and I mean this. There is one of the things which, for the Tradition audience, for the modern Orthodox audience in general, one of the things that Twersky's writings provide, and here I really recommend you put what you have to do to really get a sense of him is to take Ma'ayan HaMitgaber and put it together with Introduction to the Code of Maimonides and the Rivet and put them as a trilogy, as it were, is that the by dichotomization of Jewish studies between Chol and Kodesh is not, it's sometimes it's very important, it's very in place, but it's not necessary. There are ways in which we can expand the parameters of Torah to include disciplines and works and authors, which are generally not on the base matter, in the base matter shelf, and nevertheless enrich our lives as Jews and give us the tools to be able to deal with an ever-changing reality. And in that regard, Tradition is the obvious place for a discussion for the beginning, let's do it this way, a beginning of the discussion of Fritz Twersky's oeuvre and of his contribution to both the scholarship and to Torah and to the Jewish people, and to a vision of Orthodoxy in a very, very challenging world. So we thank you for hosting. Thank you, Professor Carmi Horowitz, for joining me. Thank you, Rabbi Jeffrey Sachs, for hosting us. And
I would like to thank you, Jeffrey, for an excellent review of the book and presenting it in such an intelligible way to the readers of Tradition. Thank you.